call this August 3rd Jackson County Commission Work Session to order. We'll have our roll call.
District 1, Mr. Guffey.
Present.
District 2, Mr. Gilmore.
Present.
District 3, Mr. Miller.
Present.
District 4, Mr. Ledbetter.
Present.
Chairman also present.
All right, we have a quorum present. Have our invocation by Mr. Porter and our pledge by Mr. Ledbetter.
Lord God, our Father, we're again blessed to be here today. We're so thankful for this country that we live in, thankful for this county, thankful for the people of the county that these fine gentlemen are able to represent. We're so thankful for them, for their public service. We pray that you'll be with them and guide them and protect them. Be with their families as they're serving and serving others. Let us all be good servants to you and to others. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Have one item for discussion. We have approval of the agenda with that, or any changes before we approve the agenda. Motion to approve the agenda with that item. Second. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye. Opposed say no. And now we've had no one sign up to speak. We have one item for discussion, and I will let Mr. Campbell explain what we've got for those matrices.
Okay, on the sheet you guys have, it's the Mack Truck Program. And essentially what that is it's joint bid for counties in Alabama. And for the past several years, the counties have purchased trucks and sold them either 1 year into or 2 years into operating. And I've gone back as far as 2010. And that first list you're seeing there is years 10 to 12. That was a two-year operation, and that was the outcome. The top line is what was paid to Nextran Truck Center when they were purchased. The figure below that is what the final amount the county received after auction. And if it's red, we lost. And if it's black, it was actually a profit. So one thing I'd like to point out, the first line there is 2 years operation, then 12 to 13, we lost 30,000. That was with 1 year operation, 13 to 14, 1 year operation, gained 41, 14 to 15, gained 18. The trucks now we paid $492,913 for. We are guaranteed a minimum auction after the auctioneers are paid for $495,690. We stand to make $2,000 on the $2,777 on the trucks we have now. That's the minimum we can make. They could sell for more than that, but we're guaranteed that amount. Just as by comparison, DeKalb County, Alabama, they run 12 dumps, 4 low boys. They auction and replace it annually. Calhoun County, Alabama, 8 dumps, 2 low boys. They auction and replace it annually. It was just outside looking in at this, and no more than I knew, it was hard for me to believe that we could run trucks for 1 year, take that depreciation hit, and still come out okay. So looking at year two, the only thing I have for comparison is that first year, 10 to 12, which doesn't look any more promising than year one based on these figures. And then, you know, at your third year of use, you start getting into expiration of warranty. Turbo, for example, I think is not covered. One of those goes, it's $5,000. So we're shooting for the March auction, which has seen the best numbers as far as results. And based on all the information I gathered, my recommendation is that we proceed with selling them on an annual basis and replace them.
Your questions or comments on this?
How many total do we have?
You have 3 dumps and 1 low boy.
We made a considerable amount of money than that when we sold the last 2 times.
Last year we did the 13-14, made a pretty good amount. Last year I don't think it came in it came in a little bit above the minimum, I think, but it wasn't as stellar as we hoped for.
Now you've probably seen the check for a larger amount than this.
Yeah, low boy too, wouldn't it?
That is because, well, that is because we've been making payments on a quarterly basis.
Right.
So when these things go to auction, you get the difference in what you've already paid into it and what they sell for and what you owe. So it's a larger number, but you kind of got to go back and look at what was actually paid and sold, not what you paid in between, if that makes sense. Any of the figures you guys want to, we can drill down into, be happy to provide more information.
It's a no-brainer, I mean, with a guaranteed, you know, the box, I mean, you can't lose money.
We're getting paid for the trucks. Any other questions or comments? All right, well, we can put this on the agenda next week to vote on, and if there are any other questions at that time. Anything else?
Do we have an estimated price on our replacement truck? Last year we got, last time we done this, we were guaranteed by Mack, we bought new truck for the same price that we bought our old truck.
Yes, sir. I noticed the last 2 years were the exact same price. I'll have to look at the paperwork and see that.
That was actually a question I remember talking about too. This next year, they were talking about the possibility of the cost going up. So I guess we would need to make sure that's okay. Still.
Gotcha.
Anything else? All right. That concludes the item for our agenda. Move on to our reports. Mr. Mann?
Nothing.
Mr. Campbell?
No, sir.
Mr. Porter?
Nothing.
You back? Mr. Riddle?
No, sir.
Yeah, Mr. Riddle?
No, sir.
All right, that concludes our meeting. We'll recess this one, so we'll do a motion to recess?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so we'll recess this and we'll reconvene at 6 p.m. up in the courtroom for our information meeting this afternoon. So with that, entertain a motion to recess. All those in favor say aye. Those opposed say no.
All right. We'll go ahead and get started. Call our, this is a continuation of our meeting from earlier. So what we wanted to do this for today, we've had several community meetings, obviously, over the past several months, just about in every part of the county discussing issues about the sales tax, trying to share information, put information out there. Been, you know, there's a lot of good questions throughout the process, and of course we wanted to provide another opportunity for folks to ask questions or continue to learn about this, and we'll continue to do that until obviously the day of the vote, and throughout the day of the vote, if anyone, you know, if there's still questions out there. We want folks to understand the facts about this sales tax, why it's being pursued, what it's being used for. You know, anything that there's a question about, we want to do our best to try and answer that. And I feel like so far through these processes, we've done that. Now, there has been a lot of misinformation going on out there as well, and that's, again, this is another opportunity in this meeting today to try and answer questions or concerns or things that you may have heard. You get straight from the horse's mouth tonight, and we've got, you know, information trying to back up, you know, the facts and the numbers that we've got. So, you know, we just want to put it out there, answer any questions that we can. So this is the presentation that we've done throughout the several months regarding the sales tax. I'm not going to go through the same presentation that we've done at all the community meetings. If you're interested in watching one of those, we do have several of those posted to the YouTube. I do want to touch a few key highlighted points, but a big part of this is to answer questions that you may have, things that you've heard. What are some of the things going on that you want to know about, whether it's where the dollars are going or whatever else? Again, we've tried to answer as many questions as possible, and we want to continue to do that until this election happens. So, with that, I'll go very quickly. I do want to make a few key points on this, and then we'll just open it up for questions, comments about the tax, or really, as we've said, anything that you have regarding Jackson County or what we've been doing as a county government. So, some key points that we've tried to get out there. The county currently gets none of the current two cent county tax. 100% of that goes to education. So the $8 million that goes toward, that is collected for that 2 cents of county tax, 100% of that goes towards education. Now, I know there's been some confusion. We've been saying 3.3 million, and folks are saying, well, half of $8 million is 4 million. And I can show you a chart here. Where we get this information from is on our RDS report. This is the report we receive from RDS, that's our tax collection agency. And if you'll, I know it's difficult to read, but if you notice this line right here, this is what this tax is going to affect, our general sales tax. It does not affect agriculture, automotive, manufacturer, or vending. So this is actually this year, and as we said, we've got actually an increase this year from what we saw last year. But based on the numbers, we looked at last year's numbers, and that's where we came up with the $3.3 million based off the numbers that we pulled off this report from last year. So that's where our number's coming from. I want folks to be very clear that this is where we're pulling the information from. So that's where we get the $3.3 million, as opposed to what the school gets their eight plus million because they receive all of these items. So I wanted to make sure we clarify that. So like I said, we get none of that current taxes received. 100% of that goes towards education. That's split between the County Board of Education and the City Board of Education. There's some other information on here about some of the dollars we do receive. Again, we've talked about the biggest thing we receive is outside of gas taxes, the property tax, and that does not do a whole lot in addition to some of the little fees that we get. It doesn't do a whole lot to help maintain county government. I think there's been questions on, dollars we get for the jail. Basically, we get about $325,000 a year between court fees and some of the other costs there to pay for a $2 million jail. So it's a very expensive endeavor, obviously, to maintain that facility, something that we have to have, but we've got to have dollars to maintain that as well. TVA in lieu of tax, we talked about that. We talked about that quite a bit. I've got some information if there are any questions on TVA in lieu of tax, but essentially that has dropped $432,000 over the past, since 2012. That's a huge hit. We expect it to go down another $150,000, $200,000 this next year, if not more, because of the closure of Widows Creek. Gas tax has dropped $300,000 over the past 4 years. I think we've looked at the numbers. We're going to receive less gas tax today than we did 10 years ago. And of course, the cost of paving has tripled in that same time frame. So the bottom line of all that is that we do need more dollars. We've got to have dollars to operate, but we also have to have dollars to invest. And I'll go real quickly again on where we're going to spend some of these dollars. But we've got to have those dollars to invest as well as just our base operations. Do want to talk real quickly about some of the costs that we've cut. We have cut a lot. We've cut several full-time positions within county government. We've cut hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of things that were wasteful spending, clearly wasteful spending, as well as other more hundreds of thousands of dollars on items that we felt we could cut and continue to work with. So again, we've cut to the point where we feel any further cuts are going to hamper services, which is why we're approaching the people now with this tax. Another thing that's come up is the cost of the election for this. This election is going to cost, well, the top amount, most elections we have cost about $80,000. That's the full-on election that we have, for general elections, which we'll have several of next year. So that's about $80,000 cost. So it's prone to cost us up to $80,000 for this election. But we had to make a decision. Did we want to continue another 6 months, wait until March, continue another 6 months on this budget deficit that we're at? That would have cost us over $175,000. If in lieu of tax drop, that would have cost us even more. We could have done that and spent even more money by waiting, or we could have went ahead and made the cuts. And we felt that asking the people, to vote on this, that the $80,000 was worth that, as opposed to making the cuts and feeling, causing that problem, in a sense, for Jackson County citizens. We wanted to invest this $80,000 to make that happen. So that is an explanation on that. Where we want to spend these dollars, again, this is probably the quickest review of this that I've made, but I do want to get to your questions quickly. So we want to spend $1.5 million toward roadways, $300,000 toward school resource officers, fire departments, $300,000 towards fire departments. There are several that have reduced funding due to a change in the village tax. So we want to repay those folks, get that money back to those departments, and hopefully be able to support them in a better way. I just got a letter actually today. I saw that Bridgeport's ISO rating dropped to a 4. So that means those folks that live within 5 miles of one of those departments is going to have lower insurance costs. So not only, on the flip side, obviously, the insurance rates go up if the ISO rating increases, but if we're able to invest even more in fire departments, insurance rates are going to go down. So, that's a very positive thing there, which really helps everybody in Jackson County. If you've got property in Jackson County, you're paying, you know, insurance. So, and then assisting community industrial business development. This is one thing that we've harped on quite a bit because this is where we're going to see the dollars come back. Right now, when we invest in industrial development, we don't see those dollars come back. Google's a great example, $600 million investment. Outside of what we see happen with TVA in lieu of tax dollars, which, you know, that's going to be up 1 year and continue down because of Bellefonte and some of the other things. Outside of that, we probably wouldn't be able to pave even a mile of roadway with the dollars that we get from property taxes or other things, you know, 100 jobs, 100 plus jobs. Even if they all built a new home, the dollars aren't there to help provide the services to those folks. So with the sales tax, obviously, if we invest in industrial business development, we bring more people to Jackson County, or we're spending more money in Jackson County because we've got better paying jobs, that means that those sales tax dollars are going to come back and we'll just be able to reinvest. So that's kind of the long-term part of this. A lot of these services we talked about are things that need to be provided, but if we want to be able to continue to sustain ourselves off this sales tax, we've got to invest in industrial development. So that's going to be a huge benefit to be able to do that. Right now, we don't have the dollars to do that. And then, of course, to take care of the general fund budget. So, with that, like I said, incredibly quick review, but we'll go ahead and get on to questions, comments, things that you've heard that you want to know, and we'll do our best to answer whatever we can. Yes?
Do you plan on spending any of this money on... Is that that Thrive 2000?
2055. Yeah. We've not been... They've approached us in the past. Obviously, the dollars haven't been there. I don't know if the commission studied enough. I've been involved with it a little bit, but right now, I don't know that there's any efforts or thoughts to do that. We've got to see where that's going to benefit us if we're going to invest in that.
Okay, and I have another question, which is, we've already gotten $2.3 million to repair the road. Why is it that you need more?
We actually have $3.3 million. $3.3 million is what we collect in gas tax. The biggest part of that, about half of those dollars go towards salaries, another half, or about $1 million of that can only be used for certain materials and equipment. So in that sense, you know, we can't necessarily pave a road with that. Some of that you purchase equipment with, some of that you can get materials for patching potholes and things like that.
Well, it says right here in it that you can use it to, when the road is 90% bad, that you can use it to repair the road, so.
Okay, there are about five or six different funds in that, and all of them have a restriction on what we can use those dollars for. The 111 fund, which is the biggest one, probably has about, that's the one that probably has about $1.5 million coming into it. And that's the one that's most unrestricted. That's also the only one we can pay our people out of. The 117, which is the road paving funds, that's what we use for a lot of the pothole patching, a lot of the millwork, some of the stuff that we do ourselves, and we do a lot of work ourselves. That's what we use that for. So if we were to cut, in other words, yes, we can use more of those dollars for paving, but in order to do that, and this is what we've talked about, in order to do that, we'd have to cut back the mowing that we do or cut back certain tile services, different things, other things that were involved, bridge repair, or bridge building. We've done a lot of that since we've been in office. I think that a lot of that was carried over from the last group too. But all those construction projects we do, we have to change that. When a road gets washed out, we do a lot of that work. So we could cut that stuff out and pay for more roadways, but you know, the dollars aren't there to do it all.
Okay, one more question. I might have another though. I'm really great for that. In your own paper that you sent to the legislature.
Is that our bill?
To get approved, your
okay,
bill.
Okay, yes. Mm-hmm.
It says here that, and I'll read it for you, it says that all such funds from the tax levy by this act shall be paid to the Jackson County General Fund to be used as all other funds paid to Jackson County General Fund without restriction or earmark, but such distribution may include, but not necessarily be limited to, the following purposes. And then you list all the things that you plan on spending it on.
Right.
But it says the verbiage is may.
Right.
It doesn't mean you will. So you could pull out and not pay that and use it somewhere else, correctly?
Is that correct? We have said where those dollars will be spent, and if we don't do it, then we don't need to be here. I've said that time and again.
Okay, so you're committed to spending it to this?
That's, yes, the dollars we've laid out, the 1.5 for roads, $300,000 for those other items, $900 towards the general fund, that will be published on an annual basis so that folks will, if this passes, so that folks will know where those dollars are going. And if we, if you're correct, it goes to the general fund, we could decide we wanted to spend all $3.3 million on, you know, building a soccer park if we wanted to. But we've said we're going to do that, and the only thing I know to say is that that's what we've said, and if we don't do it, we don't need to be here.
But we don't get to say so whether, if you come up with something you want to spend it on, we don't get to say what you, if we want you to spend it on.
At election time, you have a say to tell us whatever you want. You can tell us wherever you want to go.
Can I make a comment on the public works on the roads? The last time the gas tax was raised in 1994, we had 48 employees at Public Works. We now have 32. A ton of gravel, I think, was right at $3 a ton, and we're giving $10 or 10 something, almost $11 a ton for gravel now. The binder that we use in our tar and gravel was $1 a gallon, and it's like $7 a gallon now. I mean, increasing costs, you know, throughout the years, you know, we've done less and less employees to try to make up for, and I say we by the county. I mean, this bunch has only been here a couple of years.
We've cut several employees too.
But, you know, we came to a fork in the road where we've got to decide whether we want to go down a paved road or a road of potholes. And, you know, that's why we brought the people for the vote. I mean, it's the community's decision, and we just want everybody to have the facts, and we want them to vote on the facts. You know, if you've got misinformation, then you're getting cheated out of your vote because you're not voting, you know, what you know, and we just want to share the information. Thank you.
But follow up on that, there's, even if we vote you out, you could say the 19th after it passes, you could go get a $40 or $50 million bond or something we could do.
But what would that bond do for us?
I don't know.
There's no purpose or reason for us to do that. I can't say we're never going to get a bond, but I see no reason at all that we would pursue a $40 million bond now or after this passes. If we have the dollars to do what we want to do. Now, there's been some talk about borrowing to do some paving, and that may be done a little bit up front. But $40 million, that'd take you, with that, I mean, what, 25 years or something to pay that back?
I think you could borrow, what, 10 times of what your revenue is?
Right now, though, if that's what we wanted to do, if borrowing was our objective, we could have done that already.
That's if we're at our debt ceiling. We're not at a debt ceiling because we have very little debt.
Right.
I mean, actually, we could probably borrow that amount now.
We could borrow
the problem
65,
is making the payment because we don't have the funding.
It has to be paid back.
Right. Yeah, we could borrow $70 million if that was our intention. We could do that right now. If I say we could, we wouldn't have the money to pay it back, so I don't think anyone would come around and do that for us. But that's the fact of the matter.
But also, you say there's no tax on houses or automobiles.
This does not apply to that.
If you build a house, there's tax on the lumber, all the building materials. There's, you buy a car, there's tax on tires, batteries, whatever.
Right, yeah, it's going to apply to those things. It doesn't apply to your actual home or a mortgage that you're paying. It doesn't apply to a car or an automobile that you're purchasing.
Also, one more, no hush, but I saw in, I meant to get the date, and I didn't have time this afternoon. One of the articles in the Sentinel said that you hope to hire 2 to 3 resource officers for $300,000.
We hope to hire 5 or 6. I had this conversation with someone this weekend. I'd love to say we're going to hire 8 if we could hire 8, but I don't want to say we're going to hire 8 and then we come back and only hire 7. I want to make sure we're being as true to our word as possible. The plan is to hire 3 the first year, hire a couple more the second year, and after we've panned out and made sure everything's stable, maybe we can add another 1 or 2 after that. It's not going to be, you know, 8 all at one go, because again, we've got to make sure that these dollars are paying for. It takes about $80,000 for equipment and everything to get a resource officer started on the road. After that, you know, the annual cost is going to be much less. We can hire probably 9 if that's all we're looking at. But we've got to monitor all the costs, and that's why we've set 5 or 6 to start with.
What equipment do you have to have other than a pistol?
You got to have your vehicle. Sheriff, would you like to talk about that?
You got to have a vehicle, your uniforms, and gun belts, and all that stuff.
I worked 40-something years. Nobody ever got me a car getting to and from work.
We work the roads. We work everywhere.
He's in school. He won't be on the road.
He'll be on the road.
He's on call. How's that going to help?
There's 17 campuses in the county. I mean, we can't hire 17 police officers. We can't afford to. So, I mean, he's going to have to go from one school to the next in a given area.
So he'll watch you a week if something were to happen. He'd watch your resource officer a week, then you'd be no better than you know him. Going through team would not a, could you not
to begin with,
red orders, but that not make cheaper?
To begin with, these school resource officers are going to be certified deputy sheriffs. They're going to be sent to the police academy. They have a specialized SRO school they'll have to go to. They'll be outfitted. They will be given a car. But at the same time, if there's an emergency 2 miles from where they are, they can respond to that emergency. During the non-school months, the sheriff is going to use them wherever he needs them in the county. And I hope everybody knows we need more. So they will be a benefit.
They will escort.
Why didn't nobody advertise them as the sheriff leading deputies instead of school resource officers?
Well, we have.
That's what you're going to use them for.
Well, we have. I mean, every news article we've done is to let people know that was one of the things that people, that when we were running, that's something that people wanted. Was they wanted resource officers, but we just, when we took over and we seen how the budget was, we said there was no way. And that was what brought us to this point, was we had to do something. If we want to move forward as a county, then, you know, or we move backwards. And that's what this is all about. You know, we wanted this for the people to vote on. As long as you're informed, like you vote, that's what we want. But, you know, our sheriff's department's already way understaffed as it is for the size county we got. We have said in all the meetings, we have said that this is going to benefit. Obviously, the big purpose of this, having those resource officers in those schools, with all the things that we say going around, we think that that extra level of protection is a huge benefit. But we've said in our meetings also that having that resource available to the Sheriff's Department, if there's an absolute emergency they have to respond to, again, that's something that benefits. So that's, we've tried to explain that in all of our meetings.
Is it not true that the sheriff only has, at any given time, probably 2 deputies to cover this whole county?
Any given time, roughly, usually around 3 or 4. Right?
Yeah, 3 or 4, you know, it depends. Somebody's always going to be off. Somebody may be in sick or out sick. You know, we do a lot of transports out of county that stay going all day long. So, you know, we're, and our day shift guys are basically mailmen. They're not really out there being, you know, looking for bad guys, except from one paper to the next paper when they're traveling. So we're, you know, at times in the past we've had process service that took some of that burden off of our deputies. We don't have those anymore.
One more question. You said it wouldn't be on agriculture. What if you're going to take it off, that it's not?
The only thing this law applies to, it says it's the general sales tax and general use tax. So as far as the agriculture, manufacturing, automobiles, none of that's applicable. And I'm not sure when that, you know, may know better, Mr. Porter, when that school tax was put into place, it specifies how much is applicable to each area, but this only says for the general portion.
But there's not any sales tax now on thing you use for production agriculture.
Do you know what the agriculture and line item is, Mr. Porter?
I don't know the amount or the percentage, but he's correct. It's on agricultural products. You don't pay sales tax now, and there won't be any. This won't levy a tax.
All I know is that there's about $3,800 a month that goes toward, comes from that line item. We're not going to be collecting that. Yes.
How much of all the tickets that are written, both by the sheriff and by the city, goes, and what does it go to?
There's a law that puts in place all the dollars we get. I think it's $20 per court case, something like that. We get this $10 day fee. A lot of different things combined in this law. Out of all of those dollars, what we budget for the jail, what we get is about $325,000 total. That's the revenue we get from all those other things. So the rest of that jail operation, you know, that's all we get from those things. The rest of it's operated by the general fund, the rest of that $2 million.
Okay, and the last question I have, and then I won't say anymore. You claim you want to be transparent.
Right.
I have known on several occasions, and friends of mine, who have come down and asked for an open records request, and all you get is the runaround. And you get called a radical if you oppose what you're doing.
We have responded to every single record request we've received in our office. We've given a copy of it. And I have the actual paper to show that it was given. So if there's something else out there, everything we've received, we've responded to. Now, someone can say they didn't get it, but if they ask for it, we've given it to them.
Has this happened to you?
No, yeah.
It has happened to you?
Has it happened since we've been in office? It's been since we've been in office? Has it happened since we've been in office?
It was recently.
Okay, well, if you have a problem like that, you come see any of us. If you think it's I'm the problem, any of these guys, we want to respond to all the record requests.
So you're going to let me know anything you spend in that budget with an open record?
Yes, ma'am.
You better believe
anything you want to know, we have okay. It. We put it up on the screen right now.
Okay. Anybody that's called me, I personally given it to Commissioner Guffey.
Well, I mean, we again, if you want the full budget, we'll go down and fill out the records request after this. But we've got it right here. If you've got a question on any line item in the budget, we've got the entire budget right here to go over tonight if you want it.
I was told the other day that you have a $2 million maintenance fee for the jail. Is that correct?
The total cost to operate the jail is $2 million.
Okay, so it's not just maintenance.
No. Again, that budget's on here also if we'd like to look at it.
Is it true you're cutting some people out if you don't get this money?
If we don't have the dollars, we have a budget deficit. We have a $350,000 deficit. We know that we're going to have a drop in TV and loop tax next year. So if this does not pass, something has to be cut.
Why don't you guys cut your pay? Because you certainly get a lot more than the people.
If we cut our pay, we might get up to $200,000 a year if we totally cut it out. But then I'm going to be working somewhere else because I've got to support my family too. So, you know, we could do that. That's going to get a piece of the pie, but then you've got nobody kind of managing your dollars, so. Yes?
How much have y'all cut off your budget since last year?
We started with a $1.2 million deficit on paper. In reality, with the drops in the lieu of tax and everything else, that's about 1.6. We have $350,000 left, so we've cut at least $1.3 million out of that budget. That's through people, that's through waste, that's through other expenses that we just felt we could do without, but we've cut at least $1.3 million out. And that's just the general fund. That didn't include the cuts that we've made to public works and solid waste.
Gary Morgan, ArcLight.blogspot in the borough. I've been following the county commission for more than 15 years. I've seen a lot of faces up here. Some come and go. Had disagreements. Some of y'all have had disagreements, which is okay. That's what politics is about. That's what government's about. 10 years ago, when James Tidmore was in office, I asked some of these same questions that y'all have been asked. What is the budget? What are your expenditures? Matter of fact, the actions that was carried forth required we arranged for the budget to be posted on the bulletin board. Now, I know y'all aren't posting the budget on the bulletin board right now. I may suggest, if I could, that you do that. Let the people, so they can come in there and just look at the bulletin board without coming over here and having a discussion. I suggest you do that. But 10 years ago, the income of the Jackson County Commission was $12 million. That was the amount of money that was available to be spent. Today, the income of the Jackson County Commission is $7 million. What do you equate the reduction of $5 million from 10 years ago? And how do you think that affects you today, from services then to services now?
One thing, I've not looked back. I don't know what they were running through the general fund.
Things that we know, we've gone back as far as 5 years ago and kind of looking at some of the things that we've seen. We know that a big part of it was the, we were receiving $260,000 a year on interest from dollars that were in the bank. Interest was good, so about $260,000. That's dropped to whatever we've got now, $30,000, $40,000 a year. Obviously, we talked about TV and lieu tax dropping, gas taxes dropping. You know, all the different things from that that have well, gas tax would be a general fund. Gas or TV and lieu tax. One of the big things I think they cut, and I don't know the 12, I've not seen the 12 or whatever, but one of the big things that they cut, Jackson County was actually receiving a portion of the sales tax at one time. That was the part, a portion of that that's supposed to go to education. It was misunderstood where some of those dollars were going, so that was clarified, those dollars were put toward education like they were supposed to be. I think that was probably part of where some of that revenue was coming from, was the sales tax at that time. But it wasn't supposed to be received by the county, so as soon as they noticed that, they cleared it up and got it fixed.
Yeah, I think it was not. May have been an audit finding at one time.
Yeah, I'm not sure. Mr. Porter may know.
It was.
Yeah, coal severance tax has gone down. There's a lot of different revenue sources that may have dropped a little bit too over that time. Those are the big ones.
The reason I ask this, I'm all about public information. If I got a disagreement with you, y'all will be the first to hear it. It's important for the public to know what was then and what was now. Because it puts us in, particularly law enforcement, emergency management. I mean, you think about it. Yeah, there's $2.1 million in your emergency reserve. You call it the piggy bank, our emergency reserve. But if a tornado hits Sand Mountain, and the EMA director, the sheriffs can tell you, man, that's going to be gone just like that because you're going to need those funds available immediately. Now, yeah, FEMA's going to reimburse you. But what are you going to do? And the citizens, they think about that. What are you going to do? That's the only purpose of that fund that I've known. And like I said, I've been hearing these discussions for many years. So the county has a problem. You know, it'd be more advantageous to me as a citizen of Jackson County, citizen of Scottsboro, hey, yeah, stay away from that tax. But for me, Gary Morgan, there's people out here in this county that needs that money. There's poor people out there. Now, I've had discussions with Matthew, I've had discussions with them, and you ain't going to find any more conservative Republican than Mr. Guffey and Mr. Venable sitting there. I'm talking about physical conservative. You ask him, any of y'all, ask him what's going to happen to the county if this doesn't get approved. Ask him. I dare any of you to ask him.
I'll ask the question.
Thank you.
How could you be getting less money and you're making more? The figures just don't add up.
All I can say is we've given zero raises since we've been in office. We've not given a single raise. We did one-time pay increase of $50. Is that what it was?
I think she got disagreement.
Is there something wrong with my statement?
No. Okay.
So was it $50 one-time pay increase we did?
Yeah.
Okay, we did a $50 one-time pay increase. That came from dollars that Mr. Miller foregoes every month on his paycheck. That is the only increase we've given since we've been in office. Now, before we came in office, there were some increases that were given, several increases that were given. So, you know, I can't say why our pay is where it's at. I can tell you that we've not done anything to increase that pay since we've been here.
Mr. Chairman, I think that was $100. $100,
okay.
Do you have the omnibus bill on there?
We don't, Mr. Do you have the copy of the omnibus bill? There is a bill in place that says sets a minimum salary for all commissioners, chairmen, depending on the setup of your county and all that. We can get you a copy of that as well if you'd like to study that. But that sets the base amount, and then of course from the way it sets up, we automatically qualify. This is something else I don't necessarily agree with. Commissioners and elected folks automatically qualify for increases whenever we give the employees an increase. That probably needs to be changed, but that's the way the bill is written. That's the way the law states right now. We can get you a copy of this if you'd like one afterwards.
I'll exercise my right and come in and do an open record.
Okay.
Matthew?
Yes.
Hey, I wanted to clarify. You said that a lot of the main money comes to support the jail, everything's from the general fund?
Yes, the biggest portion.
The biggest portion, okay. So what is this court fee? Is this the state of pay that's $250,000?
Yes, the $250,000 has a piece of that $325,000 I talked about.
Okay. All right, and the coin commission, what is that?
Coin commission, that's, there's been a lot of changes on that. That may be going away essentially, but that's where when inmates use the phone, you know, they
gotcha. Making a local call, right. That's how they make them that. Right. Okay, and then they get $60,000 for the federal inmates, right?
Well, we budgeted that, but we've actually got none coming in, and that, actually that probably our number is less than 325. We've tried to get federal inmates back into our county jail. We've had no success in doing that. DeKalb County, who never stopped, they don't have, I don't think, do they have any? Do you know if they have a few?
A bunch.
DeKalb does now?
They got all the immigration people coming through there.
Okay, so DeKalb's trying to get it back.
How come we can't get the federal?
We've, I've let Mr. Harden or Sheriff, but we've tried.
Well, go ahead. Well, we've talked to U.S. Marshals. We've approved the whole federal prisoners. The problem is, under the current administration, they're not arresting people for the same crimes. The federal inmates are, population is really low. Coleman is their largest federal holding facility, Coleman and Morgan County. Those two sprung up after Jackson County was taken off the list, so they're their priority. So they have to fill those up before they can use Jackson County. We get an occasional weekend inmate that's doing a Friday night, Saturday night, Sunday gig for a DUI on a federal facility, something like that, but we're not getting anybody that's a real criminal here at this point. Now, if you had 20 or 30 prisoners every day in that jail, you'd make some money. But you're not doing it with three or four every 6 months.
We really worked hard to get them back, and we didn't get anywhere.
That's a shame. The jail store, now that, what is that? Is that where they buy candy bars and cokes and stuff like that, and they get $20,000? Now, what's this? It says transferred in. Is that from the general fund?
Right.
Okay, got it. All right. Thank you.
As far as like an industrial development, have there been experiences since you've been chairman where the county just couldn't be as competitive as other communities in bringing in these industries as far as incentives and things like that? And have we lost out on blue-collar and white-collar jobs because we just didn't have the revenue to make that happen?
The first year we were in office, we had a very good prospect looking at the building in Hollywood. Would have been 400 or 500 jobs, good-paying jobs. We lost that to Mississippi because they put dollars on the table. Obviously, there was no way we could compete with that. We don't have the dollars to do that. Had we had the dollars, would they come here? That's, you never know. But I think we definitely would have had a chance for that had we had the dollars to put on the table. So that is a, you know, pure example of something we lost because we couldn't compete for it.
Since how many jobs? Jobs?
That one, and that one in particular was, but we were told about 500 jobs on the front row.
Okay.
Okay, so you guys want to help bring industry in. What can you do that's not already being done by the EDA or the Chamber of Commerce?
Put dollars on the table.
Put the dollars on the table.
Water, sewer, gas, those things, the EDA, Chamber of Commerce, they don't have the dollars to do things where infrastructure is needed. In fact, with Google is no good example. If there's things that have to be done, a lot of those things have to come to the county because we have the mechanisms to make those things happen. So if we don't have the dollars to make those things happen, then a lot of times we miss out on that.
So we don't have any incentive. They don't have any incentives.
Right. The biggest incentive that we give is we evade our property taxes for an industry. So again, just like Google, we evade those property taxes. That means we don't get anything in order to get them here. So we won't get, even if we get a sales tax, we won't get it from Google, but all those people coming in to work with Google for Google, we get it from that. But so,
those businesses, they look at the condition of the road, the fire department's ISO rating, the infrastructure you have in place as far as sewer, gas, and those type of things. And
quality of life.
Yeah, quality of life. If we can't build those things up, we're not even going to get looked at by
So let me make sure I got this right. The gas tax, the majority of it goes to salaries. Is that right?
Half of it.
Half of it goes to salaries and nothing else. Gotcha. Okay.
Not even. Well, yeah, half if you count the insurance and things like that. Yes.
The 3 cents is 80% material, 20% equipment. That's what the 3 cents is for. Doesn't pay any salaries. So when we say gas tax, we're bundling this thing together as a whole, and we're separate accounts for this. The 3 cent tax does not pay any salaries. Make sure we're clear on this. 80% is material, 20% is equipment. Okay? Public buildings and roads fund, that's where the salaries come out of.
Well, that's our job.
Which is one problem. But the 3 cents does not pay any salaries.
The industrial park not already have water, sewer, and gas?
Yes, the one in Hollywood does, but you take an instance if there's something outside of that industrial park that wants to locate, if they have another site that they're looking for, or if we want to expand business, such as up in Section, they're working hard to get sewer up there, and they'd like to bring gas so that they can bring stuff a little bit better or heavier industry up there. Things like that, you've got to spend dollars on. The Hollywood Industrial Park does have it, but there is a cutoff. When you go from the Hollywood Industrial Park down to Stevenson, there's nothing on 72 there as far as that gas goes. When you look at the Scottsboro Industrial Park, when you go towards Huntsville, there's water, but there's no sewer or gas down that way. So, you know, even if we're just talking about our main thoroughfare, we're still lacking a lot of that infrastructure on it.
Yeah, Stevenson does have the
yes.
gas line to Big Road.
Very good gas line.
One thing on the industrial park that you're inquiring about, the reason it's got water, sewer, gas, the substation that's out there, the roads are paved, is the commission that was in place at the time had the funds available. They were a very big help in building that park. I was on the other board, the EDA board at that time, and without the commission providing the assistance they did, that park wouldn't be here. Now, needless to say, is it full? No, it's not, but it's gaining a lot of looks and getting a lot of attention. That's why folks are looking at this. Some of the folks that are out there now, KTNA, that chose to build on the other site, the only reason they came to Jackson County to look to start with is because we had that building out there and the infrastructure in place. But the previous commission that was in place at that time was a very major partner in creating that park. Because they had the funds budget.
What would you do specifically with the budget you have here, Bart, then? Say, tell the company, we'll give you $2 million to build here? Or?
Sometimes it takes something like that, and you may know Mr. Ledley here on the board, but sometimes it takes that. Sometimes it says we want a road going to our facility. Sometimes it says we want a building. There are a lot of different things, just like for doing that out at the Hollywood Industrial Park. It's getting that infrastructure to that area is a lot of times what those dollars get spent on.
The cash incentive that most of these companies are asking for, I'm talking about big companies, your Volkswagens, your other companies like that, that's what we are lacking. We can't even negotiate to say we will try to put this amount of money on the table because it's not available. Volkswagen, places like that, look for a cash incentive to build in your community. And that's just, whether we like it or whether you don't like it, that's just the long and short of it, that cash is still key.
What's the odds of recouping the money, the cash that pre-sales, I mean, through the people that live here?
If we know there's a revenue stream available, and I don't want to take up these other guys' time either, but if we know there's a 1 cent sales tax out there and we have a revenue stream that we have already put to these amounts that we said, your resource officers, the fire departments, the roads, if we have any extra whatsoever, if we get more people in the county ringing up cash registers and this thing increases, we should be able to build a fund to have that type of thing set aside for industrial recruitment. I'm speaking for myself. I'm not speaking for everybody. I've got one vote, but that's where I would say it needs to go. We need more people here. We need more jobs. I've heard it my whole life. I've been here my whole life. But you cannot do it unless you have the resources available. That's the long
and that's story. What I don't mean to cut you out. That's what I'm saying, though. If you've got the resources available, and you can decide to take TNA $2 million, are you ever going to recoup that? $2 million for the extra sales tax.
Through sales tax, yes, in our current situation.
How long would it take?
You got to gauge every business based on what you get. So if KTNA is going to hire 50 people, $2 million is not what they're going to get. If someone's coming in and hiring 500 people, then yeah, maybe $2 million or maybe $1 million, whatever. You know, those are things you've got to figure out on a case-by-case basis. This is what kind of jobs you're talking about. So this is what kind of incentive we think we can recoup from that. So you've got to look at that on every situation. We're not just going to say, here's $2 million, you know, if you're hiring five people.
Without sales tax right now, the only boost we see from a company coming in is increasing property tax if they build houses. So, you know, a $100,000 house, the county gets $60 a year on property tax. And to build that $100,000 house, and 50,000 of it was, you know, taxable items. I mean, you get a pretty good chunk of money up front and a half was built. And that would go a long way toward replacing any incentives that you give to get the company here.
That, another thing with that Hollywood Industrial Park, the county did put it into it, but it was also a federal grant participated in that. But again, had the county not had the dollars to put their matching part in, we wouldn't have even got the federal grant. So there's $3 or dollars on the table, I guess, that they took advantage of because they were able to invest in it. Just like our Atria projects cost us, I can't even remember the total cost of it now, but $8 million. But
9.2 million, I think, was the total, our part and their part.
So 9.2 million, 80-20 of that, you know, we've got $9 million worth of roads, and we only had to pay 20% of that from the county level. That was a good deal for us.
That's 34 and a half miles of road and three bridges.
Right.
Did we get any money from the toll roads?
Very little. The revenue on that is incredibly minor. It's not enough to fix the damage that they did.
And talk about coal just for a moment. It wasn't very long ago, just a few years ago, Jackson County Economic Development got $100,000 a year coal severance. That was being able to put forward some incentives. I know that's not a lot, but if you save your coins over time, it ends up adding up, and that went away. When the legislature took that away, you know, it hurt us. The coal severance that you get now as a county is all used on those routes. If you're digging coal at Fabius and you get a few funds for it, you pave the road that's on there. You can't take those funds and pave County Road 33 if you're not digging coal on it. So there's a little misconception about coal severance also. It's used for only the haul routes in which that is derived.
So what would happen if you guys you get the tax and then you guys leave office? How's the money going to be spent? Do they have the option, the new people, to do what they want to with it?
They have every option to do what they want with it. I would hope the people would hold them accountable for what they do, just like I hope the people hold us accountable for what we do.
But we don't have any protection, though.
You have an election every 2 years.
Yeah.
I mean, that's our democratic republic that we live in. That is the great protection that we have. Okay. We can always vote those people out of office.
Excuse me. We're guaranteed a republic, not a democratic.
I said democratic republic.
But the other question is okay, this tax is going to be forever.
Yes, well, I mean.
You don't, every year you're going to do it. I mean, you're not going to change it. It's not going to go away in a year. You're going to continue to take that penny every year.
Right, for the future that we see, yeah.
Okay, and one more thing I want you to know is that there is a law on the record that the Agenda 21 is illegal. And Thrive 2055 mirrors Agenda 21 and can be matched up to it and shown. So I hope you don't spend on the Thrive 2055.
We haven't spent a whole lot of time researching that unless these guys have a little more information. I've not had time.
It's not on our list of funds.
They came to their meeting the first year or so that was in office. I heard anything from the Clinton.
I will say this, I'm not going to say that we'll ever take this, I'm not going to say this tax is going to stay on forever, but I will say this, the way that this law is written, if this passes, the commission has the authority of up to one penny. So if we're still here or somebody else is here and says, you know what, this is doing great, and we always laugh and we talk about government lowering taxes, but that's something that we're all very keen on if there's a possibility doing in the future. But if they want to, they can always lower. They can make it 0.8 cents if they see that's what they need. They can make it 0.5. They can get rid of it altogether because of how the law is written. So the ability is there to do it if they want to. But again, it's going to be up to the people. If they see it's not being spent, then the people are going to have to say, we don't think you're doing that. You don't need to do that.
Personally, if I was still here and we're getting more funds than we needed to run the government, I would offer that extra money to some of the municipalities to lower their sales tax, to keep the counties in the sales tax because it benefits us in so many ways. It's a growth tax. The state of Alabama for every while continues to buy property in Jackson County, but thousands of acres, and they don't pay any sales tax, I mean any property tax. So we lose that revenue. And if we use that property for trails or tourism of any kind, any money we put into building a visitor center or trail or anything else, we don't see any return from it. So it doesn't benefit county government to promote and to
promote our natural resources. So I would want to keep the sales tax in place for the county, but, you know, I would be willing to try and bring the sales tax down through the municipalities.
One other question. What are you looking at if this doesn't pass? I mean, let's just get down to it. People need to know. Why do you, you know, what is plan B? Nobody likes talking about cuts, but it's a fact.
Plan B is to cure the deficit. And whatever that entails when budget time comes around, we have committed ourselves to passing a deficit-free budget. And it will probably, you know, you can't sit here and say what it's going to entail till we start getting into it. We can give you some examples. The roads is number one. You know, we cannot continue maintaining what we have with the amount of funds that's available. The budget we will pass, I believe, I wholeheartedly believe, will be zeroed out. And I can't personally tell you, some of these others may can, of what that's going to entail yet, but it's going to probably cut in every department.
In every allocation that we...
Every allocation.
All the appropriations that we have left will probably be the first thing to go. You know, any appropriation to do, whether that be rescue squads, libraries, what else we got?
Senior centers.
Senior RX is a program. Any of those appropriations that kind of benefit some of that stuff is going to be cut. After that, the only place that we know left to cut is our hours or people in one form or fashion or another. So that's either closing the courthouse once a week or a combination, depending on the big question is going to be how much does TV and lieu tax drop this next year. But closing courthouse once a week, cutting additional jobs, it's going to cut salaries after we cut out those appropriations. Those are the two places that we've really got left to cut.
And if you cut the fire departments, our insurance is going to go to the sky.
Well, that's the thing. We're not giving the fire departments now, so if they can't recover some of this lost funding, then, right, that is a potential negative on that.
I want to make that clear. We haven't removed any money from the fire departments.
Right.
That's something.
But you don't have any to give them.
Right. But they have received a cut, a loss because of that change.
I have a question about TVA. I've only lived here about 3 years, but it seems like TVA's contribution has been reduced every year. And is there any sign that that will level off sometime? Or so a year from now, you'll be expecting it to be reduced again?
Yes, sir. The TVA in lieu of tax, the TVA in lieu of tax has reduced every year. A big reason why that is because of the coal plant closing down and because Bellefonte is under accelerated depreciation. So those items are what continue to cause that to drop. So here's our chart on our TVA in lieu of tax, where they've gone from year to year. So we expect that to continue to drop. We expect it to drop for two more years because they continue to depreciate Bellefonte. The coal plant is going to be, you know, gone. And then we expect a rise, a slight rise from Google because they are a huge power user. And then we expect that to go down even further. Now, here's something else with TVA and lieu tax. If we want it to ever come back or if we ever want to see it stabilize, we've got to invest in industrial development. Power sales and assets out in Jackson County are the two things that make TVA and lieu tax what they are. Now, we've been very fortunate because we've had Bellefonte and the coal plant. We're very fortunate that Google is coming, but we're going to have to work. We've got to take this opportunity that TVA has given us and work incredibly hard to capitalize on that so that we can get more Googles or Amazon or Yahoo or whoever else to locate also so that we can see that stabilize. But unless we invest in industrial development and see that power usage increase, then TVA we expect to continue to grow. So, again, we've got a fantastic opportunity to take advantage of with Google. We've got to have the dollars to be able to do that. And what Mr. Bennett was saying about reducing other fees and things like that, if there's a way to reduce fees elsewhere, again, if we see in lieu of tax rise, there's opportunities there that then we can reduce fees elsewhere if we see these dollars come back. But it's not going to happen unless we make the investments.
Are all y'all on board with this need for the 1%, every one of you?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Can I just make a quick statement?
Yes.
Okay. So taxes are going to have to be raised just to maintain the quality of life that we have right now. We're we're losing money standing, right? So rather than tax the property owner in Jackson County, the business owner in Jackson County, why don't we do a fair tax through a sales tax and tax the man from Birmingham who's coming to Skyline to hunt on forever wildland, the fisherman from Illinois who's coming to fish on Lake Garner, people passing through, the same person that gets lost on the trails in High Top that uses the rescue squad and the High Top volunteer fire department. I mean, they're going to use up county resources, and then when they stop at the store and buy a candy bar and a Coca-Cola, we don't even get a portion of that as far as the sales tax. I believe that we should all, you know, pay $32 in sales tax for the equivalency rather than every property owner in Jackson County increase their property tax by $200 or $300. Would you agree? Rather than increase these things and more or less saddle the Jackson County resident with the burden of providing all these services, let's spread it around. Everyone who enjoys these services should come pay them. That's just my opinion.
Can I follow up on that a minute?
Sure. Like,
they're talking about all the people coming in. I've got to go on business. They go in 2 days. On the hotel room, there's $54.02. Why do we not look at something? I could do a half a cent tax and then let these people come in. Scottsboro really has exploded in motels for the last few years.
The dollars, that's something we looked at a couple of years ago. The problem is the dollars aren't there to fix the problem and move us forward. There'd be a few dollars there and
a lot of dollars there.
There are a lot of dollars, but it's nowhere near what we're gonna see off the sales tax. Again, it may fix our current deficit. I don't even think it's enough to fix the current deficit if we were to put an extra dollar, I think is what is in place now, a dollar and 1 cent.
$300,000, we'll put a dollar.
But could you not do a half a cent sales tax and something like that?
Oh, that may be a possibility. The problem is anything like that we do, again, we go through the legislature. We're focusing on a sales tax at this time because instead of putting five or six different things out there and hoping that one of them passes, we felt that we needed to focus on one thing. Now, if this passes, maybe that's a way to go. Maybe we can say, well, next year let's look at doing a lodging tax and bring the sales tax down to offset that. But we can't gamble in that sense on putting five or six different things out there. As they said, we've got to balance our budget. We've got to have a solution going forward.
The county, like he said, we have to go through legislation to get anything done. Municipalities, you know, they can put on another 1 cent sales tax or lodging tax or anything else anytime they get ready to. I mean, they're governed through the city council, and the commission has to go through the legislation to get anything done.
Now, isn't the legislation debating right now about another 1 cent for the statewide? Yes, they are.
I've not seen that.
That's why they call a special session. They started today. Yeah. And the governor wants to balance the budget, just like you guys want to. But they're talking another 1 cent statewide. So we're looking at 11 cents for Scottsboro.
That was not the original plan, so he's come up with a new proposal, I guess.
I was talking to the House representative.
Okay. You know, again, we can do our best to manage the dollars we have, and I can't speak for the state and how they do business. All I can speak for is the county.
But that would be just the whole state. It just wouldn't be Jackson County. It would just be the whole state.
That's another thing, too. I want to step on just for a minute. We keep saying we're going to 10%, 10%, 10%. That's the city of Scottsboro and some municipalities. Jackson County Commission is asking for 1 cent. We're not asking you to increase our amount that we already get because we don't get any. We're asking for 1 cent. The state's got four, municipalities have got theirs added on it. Jackson County has zero for the general fund. 1 cent is what we're debating here. Not 10 or 11. 1 cent.
I know it's not enough to make that much difference. You're talking about all the money municipalities are getting.
Right.
Why can they not support their own fire departments more than we're already supporting them?
Some of them do, but some of them are in rural areas where we don't have a municipality. I I live in Crow Mountain. Crow Mountain, we're not incorporated. I mean, Crow Mountain Fire Department stands on its own.
Macedonia, Higdon, all of North Sand Mountain.
Through the valley.
Right. There's several fire departments outside of municipalities that have to be supported. And even the ones in municipalities, you know, they're going to survive, but it's going to put a lot more stress because of that change in the funding.
The ones that are in the rural area go out, the association sets their district, so they'll have to travel out further. Like Skyline, they might survive, but if Crow Mountain didn't survive, Skyline might pick up Crow Mountain coverage area, so that's going to put a greater burden on Skyline's fire department.
Maysville does this thing every year, and it's called Chicken Soup. And they make hundreds of dollars, I mean thousands of dollars every year. They do benefits, you know, they and it's for the fire department. Well, I go every year, and you can buy the soup. You know, they all get together, and I mean, they make a lot of money, and it supports.
I think all of our fire departments should be community, especially. I mean, those guys give up their time. I mean, I've had to call them. I mean, they came out to Hayfield and helped me with my dad. Had an accident. And if it hadn't been for them, I'd been there for quite a while by myself waiting on some help. Those guys already give up their time to help people in bad need, car wrecks, fires, whatever. And, you know, they don't need to give up their time having a fundraiser. I mean, they already give up enough time for me and for you and for everybody in this room. And I want to help them.
The one final thing on that with the fire departments, and we, like I said, we've got several outside municipalities, but that fire in Higdon, a great example of how several fire departments had to come together. We had 8 county departments come together on that fire, one from Georgia also, one from DeKalb County. So even though a municipality has those fire departments, they may not have the resources. If there's a big enough issue, they may not have the resources and may have to call on those departments around them. So again, that's why it's so important to keep these departments operating. Anything else?
Can I ask a member-related question? We've been promised for 20 years that the commissioner would be elected on a staggered term in the district. Is there any hope? Crossbar control
next
everything
year.
Now.
You have 2 commissioners coming up next year and then 3 in 2 years from that. So from this point forward, we will be staggered.
But it's still county-wide where Scottsboro would be the, where this population would be the one that elected instead of District 1.
Oh, you're talking about changing it by district.
Yeah, instead of District 1 electing Mr. Guffey, why would, you know.
That will take a legislative act.
It would. Yeah. So we didn't talk to speak legal.
That is correct. We're all for it.
I thought it had already passed. And that all we're not doing. I thought it had already passed.
I thought that was a problem with the line.
Chairman Harris. We
clarified lines and everything else that we've had questions on.
So what do we need to do? Just you guys do up, draft something up and send it to Steve?
If the people want it, something needs to be discussed. I personally like the way it is because we have a commission that works together. It's not just concerned with one district, but concerned about the entire county. I think that's the way we need to work as a commission, is that we consider all the needs of Jackson County. Now with that, obviously, I think we try to work together. If there's a, you know, road dollars, we tried to split that up when we last year. The 8 miles we did our best to try to split that up where needed between the districts. But
I hope additional cost also.
What?
If we do, I did check into it, and if we do district voting, there's some additional cost because you have to, the way I understand the law, you have to have a road department, you have to staff, you know, we'd have to build a building in each district,
separate
quite Madison County. And when you do that, you times everything by 4, so your employees are going to go up, you know, and if you ain't got the money, then, you know, what was the point of it? So after I got checked into it, that's the reason it kind of died down, and legislator at the time didn't want to, push it.
Any other questions or comments?
Comment about school resource officers a little bit, because you had a question about that. Why don't they just lock the doors? Well, stats show that the people that have broke into these schools and killed them, killed our children, have gone through locked doors because they either went to school there or they shot through the glass doors and went in there and killed these kids. And the stats also show that when their school resource officers are there, people do not use those places as a target. So maybe that'll help you on that.
having a car there is also a big benefit. If they see a patrol car there, guess what? They're not going to our schools. We're the only county in North Alabama that does not have school resource officers. That's sad. And if you're somebody that's going to make a statement, guess what? You're going to Jackson County, Alabama, to do it.
I guess my only thing about that, my two sons, well, the oldest one especially, went from North Jackson as a resource officer, and all the kids there said he never did anything except sit in his office. Nobody ever saw him.
And every one of them kids knew exactly where to find him and knew his name, I guarantee you.
One of our resource officers raped a child. That's what I have a problem with. And I know it ain't, no, everybody's not like that. But why don't we send some of these teachers and principals to some gun ranges and learn how to pack and bring it in themselves? I mean, I have no problem with that. I would be glad.
Why don't we give each kid a knife and tell them to defend themselves too?
Well, no, you can't do that.
That is insane. You've got one person that specializes in what he does. He's a law enforcement officer. These kids can go to him when they've been molested. These kids can go to him when they don't have resources at home to take care of. The officer may sit in his office quite a while. He's getting paid for what he might have to do. Let that school get shot at. Who's the first target? That officer. Who's the first one to die? That officer. To say, to put a price tag on your kids, that's just insane. I mean, that's crazy. If we're not even going past the 1 cent, You can't put a
clock
there and protect the kids.
And offer a starting pay of about
$14
an hour.
That low zero starts out at $14.25. Jackson County starts out at $14.27 for a deputy on the road.
I think it's a peace of mind. I know it would be for my children. And also, Jackson County is the third largest county in the state of Alabama. And I think it's a shame we don't have the funds to do it.
And when something happens on North Sand Mountain, how long is it going to take your department to get up there?
Well, hopefully we keep a car on that end of the mountain when we can. So, they try to stay Flat Rock north to Bryant because it is such a rural area. And we do not respond to calls from the courthouse. Our guys are out there riding around. We just don't have enough of them. So, it could take as long as 30 or 45 minutes to get there, depending on the time.
Any other questions?
I don't have a question, but I'd like to make a statement. Thank you for all the transparency you've tried to have, and for you guys going around and listening to all of us ask questions and criticize and not know what we're talking about. So I appreciate
you.
You're doing a good job.
I wanted to say one thing. I've said it in other meetings that I've been at, but how many times do we get in a car and drive to Huntsville or Chattanooga, maybe looking for a specialty item or eating somewhere? We're using our time, our gas, wear and tear on our car, spending our dollars in another state or another county, not really benefiting where we live at, and I'd rather pay a penny on a dollar. And I find myself riding the road a lot for certain things that, we could have that convenience here. So, and we have some specialists as far as physicians here, but, things could change, and we can have more specialists here if we have something to offer to people. And that can definitely happen. We need to move Jackson County forward.
Thank you.
Back to what Libby was talking about, if the fire departments in rural areas close down and the insurance goes up, has anybody looked at what that's going to factor in on how much someone's going to have to fork out, plus adding on to the millage tax? It's going to, I would think, that it would be more than $34.
We had one person, I think, maybe worked at the sheriff's department. They were telling us, their district changed and it almost doubled what their cost on insurance, I think, if I'm correct on that. So, you stand at if you're outside that 5 mile radius, and if that fire, so if that fire department closes and you're inside that, then you're now outside, you see a huge increase in your cost.
And also in certain areas, you can't get a loan to build a house if the fire department isn't nearby ready.
Right. Anything else?
I'd like to say one thing. You know, this commission is committed to do what we were sworn to do. It's not pleasant. None of us like the tax. Everywhere I go, and I'm sure these people have too, the ones that are against the tax say, if you pass this tax, you're out of office. Why are you passing this tax? We don't have the authority to pass this tax. We have one vote. All we're doing is giving the people of Jackson County a chance to vote either yes or no. We can't do it alone. So I just wanted to clarify that.
Yeah, I wanted to clarify too that I think the lady back here had asked about the salaries of the commissioners. One thing I'd like to make known to everybody, and Mr. Label won't tell nobody, but he gives his whole check away. So he don't keep his check. So people say that he's in it for the money, or any of us in it for the money, is sadly mistaken. Mr. Miller gives a big portion of his away. It's gone. And I couldn't tell you, it's every week we're doing something where we're taking out of our back pocket and giving. I just want to clarify that we're, I don't know who thinks we're getting rich up here, because I promise you, we're doing this for that. I run, and I know the rest of these guys done the same as me, we run to better our community. That's all I wanted, was to make sure that my kids had it better than I had. I want to make sure our schools are better. I want to make sure our roads are better. I care about the people of this county, and that's it. So we're trying to be, if we were trying to lie to people and not be transparent, we wouldn't be going to communities every other week for months, telling people. We'd just say, hey, we're going to vote, and then we would shut up about it and let it go, and nobody, not even say a word about it. But we want people to know about it. We encourage people to learn the facts. We want people to go out. And if you're against it just because you're against the tax, that's great. I'm fine with somebody being against it just because maybe they're just against the tax. But to be against it because of a lot of the lies that's been told and spread on Facebook and all these other things, at least be aware of what the truth is. That's all I ask. And I appreciate everybody coming today, whether you're for it or against it. I appreciate everybody coming.
I'll tell you one thing, everybody for coming out. I mean, I appreciate your involvement in the community. We cut well over $1 million from our budget. We were still facing this huge problem. I mean, we don't have the money to do the things that need to be done, let alone the things that we think we would like to do to better our community. That was too big of a decision for us to make. We put it to the vote of the people. I personally, I'm going to vote yes. I've not told a single person they need to vote yes. I've not told a single person how to vote. This is a community's decision, and that's the way it should be. I just want everybody to have the facts and not expect to vote no and something be different. I mean, we're telling you the truth, the way things are. And again, I appreciate everybody coming out.
I too like to thank you for coming out here. I want you to do one thing. Educate yourself on the facts, not what your neighbor says, not what your cousin says. Educate yourself on the facts of this tax. This is not 1980. This is not 1990. The time we're living in, expenses have shot through the roof to continue doing business. When you're talking about paving and you're talking about the sheriff's office, you know, the sheriff's office, I want to mention this real quick, not because he's here, but it is ridiculous the amount of people that work in this department cover the mileage that we're covering. Again, we think in the back of our mind, things are not important until it comes an emergency. You know, it may not be your emergency, it may be yours. It's something to really consider. These resource officers are very important to me, personally. I think they should be in those schools. I think it can detour some bad things just by that presence. I think it's very important. The volunteer fire departments, again, personally, it's very important to me. Mr. Venable said it a while ago, and it made more sense than anything in the world.
they should not have to volunteer their time to fundraise, because they already volunteer their time to take care of us and protect us. I think it is our obligation as citizens of this county to fund these folks. That's just that the way it is. This thing is very important. If you do not understand something, please get the information. It's readily available. We'll get it for you if you need to speak. But please educate yourself, talk to your friends when you have the correct information, and then let's make a decision August 18th. And thank you for coming tonight.
Chair, Revenue Commission, you guys have anything to add?
I don't have.
We do thank everyone for coming. We hope folks will watch. Again, we've got three cameras here, so there should be no shortage. If you've got friends or family that want to see the discussion, again, it's there. If you have a question or a comment or concern, again, we've got information here. We've got information coming. We want to talk to you about it if there's still questions, or if you know someone that has questions. And like it's been said, you know, all we can do is what we've got, based on the information we have, and this is the information we have. And I think it's something to say that 5 out of 5 commissioners think that this is the best option. It's not the only option. There are a lot of options out there, but this is the best option that we have to pursue if we really want to see a bright future for Jackson County. If we want to invest in these things we've talked about, this is where we feel is the way to go with it. So they pretty much said everything, and we've got 2 more weeks to work on this. We're going to continue to share the information. Again, if someone has questions, we want to do that. And after that tax vote, regardless of whether it passes or fails, we're going to continue to share the information on what's going on with the budget. That's what we feel like we were elected to do. Hopefully it passes and we can show that those dollars are being spent where we've said we're going to spend them. And we can set up a precedent that folks won't want to change in the future, because again, those dollars are invested wisely. So we want to show the citizens of Jackson County that we can do that, and we will do that. So with that, thank you all again very much for coming. We'll continue working, and thank you very much.
Hey, remember, the camera's still on. If you want a budget, call the commission office. And I promise you, if somebody in the commission office comes in, call me. I will hand deliver to you. Because it's been said that we wouldn't give it out, and we'd give it out if comes to requests. So if you want it, call us. I want everybody to know what we got coming in, what we got going on.
Gary Williams got it posted.
Yeah,
on his blog. Anybody wants to take a look at it? Search Gary Morgan.
Blogspot.com. Just scroll down, it'll be there. Besides the city meetings and the county meetings.